Penguin Random House Audio presents America's Bank, The Epic Struggle to Create the Federal Reserve by Roger Lowenstein. Read for you by Robertson Dean. We do not think it fair that men should raise the cry of a central bank or summon the ghost of Andrew Jackson. Nelson Aldrich. Introduction. So pervasive is its influence that Americans today can scarcely imagine a world without the Federal Reserve. To begin with, the Fed, America's central bank, issues the Federal Reserve notes that we call money. It sets the short-term interest rate that affects the market for mortgages, car loans, corporate debt, and even the level of the stock market. It manages, sometimes adroitly and sometimes wantingly, the supply of credit, whose ebb and flow alternately buoys and batters business. It supervises, or is supposed to supervise, the nation's banks. And, as Americans were vividly reminded during the meltdown of 2008, the Federal Reserve acts as the lender of last resort, providing loans to banks when credit shuts down. Barely a century ago, the Fed did not exist. Every other industrialized nation had such a central bank to oversee its banking system and to assure stability, yet America's financial system, if system one can call it, was antiquated, disorganized, and deficient. The United States boasted the world's largest economy. Its vast territory was ribboned with railroad tracks and telephone wires. Its cities were bursting with factories churning out iron and steel. Yet, almost as if history had missed a turn, its banks were disconnected and isolated, left to prosper or flounder or fail according to the reserves of each individual institution. As Paul Warburg, one of the heroes of this story, was to observe with his trademark acuity, America's banks resembled less an army commanded by a central staff than they did an inchoate legion of disjointed and disunited infantry. It was hardly surprising that throughout the latter half of the 19th century and into the early 20th, the United States, alone among the industrial powers, suffered a continual spate of financial panics, bank runs, money shortages, and indeed, full-blown depressions. This book tells the story of how, culminating in the days before Christmas 1913, the Federal Reserve came to be. It was not a gentle or an easy birth, nor was it swift. To Americans of the early 20th century, especially farmers, the prospect of a central bank threatened the comfortable Jeffersonian principle of small government. To a people for whom local autonomy was sacrosanct, the notion of a powerful bank joined to an even more powerful federal government was deeply unnerving. Opposition to central authority had animated the Minutemen at Lexington and Concord, and the battle to establish the Fed resembled a second American Revolution. A financial revolution. America had, of course, experimented with central banking early in its history. After the War of Independence, a military success but a financial disaster, the government was saddled with debt. When in due course the Constitution was ratified, providing a greater degree of political unity, Alexander Hamilton proposed a financial equivalent, a Bank of the United States, modeled after the Bank of England. Thomas Jefferson was mightily opposed, as were his many followers. Nonetheless, President Washington was persuaded, as was a majority of Congress, and in 1791, the bank, headquartered in Philadelphia, opened for business. To modernize, the bank was a strange beast, 20% owned by the government and 80% by private investors. It was authorized to hold the government's deposits, but not, specifically, to be the nation's monetary steward or to perform other functions of a central bank. Nonetheless, the bank began to play this role. In particular, it strengthened the previously shoddy credit of the federal government. The 20 years of its initial charter were generally prosperous, and the number of private banks which received charters from the states swelled from 5 to more than 100. But the bank was doomed by the rise of the Anti-Federalists, both in the White House, in the person of James Madison, and in Congress. Rechartering failed by one vote in each chamber. Thus, in 1811, America was returned to a condition of monetary innocence, or laissez-faire, money again being the business of individual banks in the states, each of which issued notes according to its respective powers. Inflation followed, and when the government's credit became overtaxed by the War of 1812, banks suspended operations, causing Madison to rethink matters. In 1816, Congress, now with Madison's endorsement, chartered the Second Bank of the United States. The Second Bank, though endowed with more capital, was in most respects a replica of the first. It succeeded at restraining the state banks from issuing too many notes, thus keeping a lid on inflation. It worked to mute excesses in the business cycle, and the bank's notes were widely accepted as a common currency, no small thing for a nation pushing across an unsettled continent. But the Second Bank met a fate no better than the first. Although Congress approved its recharter, the margin was not sufficient to override the determined veto of Andrew Jackson. In 1836, the National Bank was, for the second time, allowed to expire. Once again, the country experienced an inflation, this time followed by a severe depression. In 1841, Congress chartered a third bank. President John Tyler, a Southerner preoccupied with states' rights, vetoed it. And there, for some 7 decades, matters rested. Given the two banks' overall effective records, and allowing for some stumbles by each, the question must be asked, why such a haste to abolish them? Despite their success, many Americans regarded the banks with profound suspicion. Alexis de Tocqueville, the French political thinker who toured Jacksonian America, noticed in his travels through what was still a frontier society a pair of seemingly inconsistent facts. The notes of the Second Bank were valued equally on the edge of the wilderness as they were in Philadelphia, testifying to the people's general regard for its credit. Nonetheless, the bank had become the object of intense hatred. De Tocqueville's diagnosis was that Americans are obviously preoccupied by one great fear, which he identified as fear of a tyrannical government, or, as he put it, of centralization. De Tocqueville was plainly bewildered. To him, to most any Frenchman, the Bank of France seemed a natural outgrowth of the national government, no less French than the Court of Versailles. But in America, such a bank did not seem natural. It reawakened Americans' primal anxieties, the colonials' fear that their hard-won liberties would be crushed by a far-off king. Even after independence, the pattern of settlement, the way that the frontier continually pushed westward, ensured that a perpetual class of outsiders would resent and resist the power structure in the East, and especially the Northeast. For the opposition to central banking was always a matter of geography as much as anything else. In the vote to establish the first bank in the House of Representatives, only 3 congressmen from southern states voted in favor. Only 1 from the North was opposed. It was no accident that Jackson, the slayer of the Second Bank, was a rough-hewn soldier and Indian fighter, the first president not from the Eastern Seaboard. Many early Americans were not merely suspicious of a federal bank, they were suspicious of any big bank, a prejudice that loomed especially large in rural areas. To merchants and city dwellers, banks were a boon, but farmers and debtors, often the same people, resented being hostage to banks, especially large metropolitan banks. And most of America, for a very long time, was rural. When Jackson was elected president, only 1 of 15 Americans lived in cities. Although Europe also had agrarian traditions, farmers in Europe lived in villages. They were surrounded by neighbors, accustomed to interdependence. In America, farmers were dispersed and isolated. They relied less on labor, which was scarcer, and more on capital, which is to say, they relied on banks. It has been wittily suggested, not without cause, that American farmers hated banks because they needed loans. Jefferson, in particular, was suspicious of finance, a profession he considered ethically tainted. It is worth noting that Jefferson never visited a town until he was almost 18. Jackson similarly frowned on financiers. He squashed the Second Bank largely because, he felt, it was a tool of Eastern elites. As a young man, Jackson had sold land in return for promissory notes from a Philadelphia merchant and endorsed the notes to pay for supplies for a store. When the merchant failed, Jackson was liable, leaving him with crushing debts. The experience forever soured the future president on high finance. Jackson's heritage was remarkably enduring. Even generations later, the reformers who sought to establish the Fed could not admit to favoring a central bank. The very phrase was forbidden. Rhode Island Senator Nelson W. Aldrich, the first legislator in the 20th century to draft a bill for a national bank, felt as though he were doing battle not just with the populists and anti-bank agitators of his own time, but also as he.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.